regularly scheduled Board of Education meeting. At this time, if everyone would please turn off their phones, I'd appreciate it. It interferes with our TV feed. And then if you would all stand and join me in saying the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We have a full house tonight. Welcome, everybody. I think we'll start with roll call. If you could say the roll, please.
I can. President Brennstatt?
Here.
Vice President Singer? Here. Secretary McFarland? Absent. Treasurer Wasserman?
Here.
Member Baker?
Here.
Member Frazee?
Here.
Member Gorton?
Here.
All right, 6 out of 7.
Scott had to miss tonight because he had a back issue. He's been laid up, so he's got a problem.
Ouch. Yep. Okay, well, we hope he feels better soon. All right, moving into item 2, which is our consent agenda tonight. 2.1 is approval of meeting minutes from our last meeting, August 15th. 2.2 is projector purchase. 2.3 is the following staff members who have announced their resignations with the effective dates listed. 2.4 is persons who are recommended for employment for this school year. So this probably almost completes our 51 new hires. So we welcome all these.
We may have one more.
Oh, okay.
We had an art position
open
the Friday before Labor Day, and so we were interviewing today.
Okay, excellent. Well, welcome to these people. And 2.5 is legal invoices for payment. Do I have a motion?
I move to approve consent agenda items 2.1 through 2.5.
I'll support that.
Okay, moved by Pam, supported by Yvonne. Is there any discussion? Any questions?
I like those low legal fees.
Yeah. Yeah, you have to define that one. $49 is not too bad, right?
All right. All those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? All right, the consent agenda passes. Moving into item 3, Board of Education matters. First up is our 2015-16 audit report. I'll turn it over to you, Bob.
Okay, like we do on an annual basis, we go through our audit at the end of the year from June 30th, and it takes this part and this long to get to a final presentation, and we have Mr. Dave Youngstrom here from Yo and Yo, our auditing firm, and he'll present the Midland Public Schools 2015-16 audit report.
Can you hear me okay? Mm-hmm. Good evening, everybody. Thank you for having us. On behalf of Yo and Yo, we're pleased to present your audit 2015-16 school year. I guess I want to talk a little bit about all those things we have going on right now. Obviously, there's a lot going on with the district. We have teams in the business office, as well as our big projects that have been going on all summer. And I think it's a credit to Mr. Cooper and Ms. Holderby and their staff for us to be here in September presenting this to you already. So I give a lot of credit for that. Oh, sorry.
Better now?
Better.
Anyway, my voice carries that here. So. Anyway, got a few results I want to go through in a few slides. You have several documents in front of the audit report as well as our communication letter. We went through that in detail at the FFO meeting. Last Monday, so we spent a lot of time in there doing that. And we just kind of have a summary for you tonight. So I'll take any questions as we go. First thing, our report card, what are we getting? We are getting an unmodified opinion. That is, means there's no modifications that were necessary to be in compliance with standards. It's the highest level of assurance we can give on a statement and a clean audit. So that's what you're looking for. So good job. Take a look at our general fund, which is our major operating fund. And then our snapshot in time, which is our balance sheet. We compare it to 2016 and 2015. Most of our balance sheet is made up of cash. We have a lot of cash on hand at the end of the year, $7.7 million. But the biggest piece on there is what the state and federal government owe us. They owe us about $9.6 million this year, pretty consistent from the prior year. You'll notice a new thing. We have pledges receivable this year, about $2.4 million, which is fantastic. That is great community support. I'll tell you, I've only seen pledges on another school district and never to this significant. So it's great to speak to the community, reaching out to help the district make some of these great improvements for our kids. It's awesome. So a little bit over $20 million. Again, the 2.4 will come in over time. Our largest liabilities we have are our accrued salaries and fringe benefits, which is mostly our 10-month employees, our teachers, and our 10 other employees worth 10 months, about $7.4 million. And then you can see down below, we have our pledges below. That's deferred revenue up until the next year's I don't collect that. So that'll be collected over time. So it doesn't impact your general fund until you collect the cash. Overall, what we have left is our fund balance, and it's nice to see our fund balance at $9.7 million, up a little bit this year, $1.3 million. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a slide that we have coming up. Statement of revenues, expenditures, and changes in fund balance, really our operating statement, where are we at, what we're doing. You can see revenues at $79.7 million, up from $79.3, basically flat, up about 0.5% there. Expenditures, where we really save some money, $78.4 million. Down from 79.8, so a drop of only about 2%. It's a big number, but it's only 2% at the end of the day. So our swing from year to year was just about $1.9 million compared to the almost $500,000 loss we had a year ago, and almost $1.4 increase this year, leaving our fund balance at that 9.7 number. So what do we see when we compare ourselves to our budget and looking for large variances? We really fortunately don't have very many. Our final revenue budget was a little bit higher than we actually came in, and that's really mostly grant related. When you're doing your budget amendment in May and June, you're trying to guess whether those federal grants will be spent before June 30th or into the next year, because those grants typically run September to September. So it's not money that's lost the district, it's money we're not sure exactly where the grant's going to come in at, and you don't have the corresponding expenditure until the next year, so there's no lost funds there. So that's only about 3.3% down. And the expenditures were down just about 2%, really less than 2%, 1.7% swing there. So very, very close. And then you can see comparing this current year to the prior year, very similar to your budget numbers. Revenues were up about 0.5%, really basically flat again compared to the prior year. And expenditures were down about 1.8%. So even a far cry from where we were a year ago. So where are we getting our funding from? No surprise, we're getting our biggest piece of ours from the state. Up a percent again this year to 65%. That's been a trend. We've been creeping up every year a little bit. The local revenue stayed about 28%, as did our interdistrict, and our other expenditures has really kind of faded away. And we'll talk a little bit about why that is in a minute. Again, not a big piece that we have, but pretty consistent from year to year in our revenue side. We're collecting taxes and we're collecting state aid. General fund revenues over time, this really shows you, how very consistent we are from over the 5 years. The biggest change we've had, and you see that the yellow strip is really our countywide millage. We get the funding for that, which is about $4.7 million. Our state revenues, $50.9 to $50 million this year, and a little uptick in property taxes kind of offset each other there. Overall revenue, very, very consistent. So where are we spending our money? Again, no surprise, on our employees. Our best asset we have, our salaries and employee benefits, is up to 87% of every dollar we get in goes to our employees for salary and benefits. That's up a percent this year. Purchase services, pretty consistent, 0.5%. Materials and 4%, and others are sitting around 4% as well, which includes some debt payments. And you'll see our capital outlay this year is down, is really less than 1% now, where that was where we had some money before. And that's really, the sinking fund is really kicking in for some of that dollars. So that's one of the reasons we passed that is to take some of the burden off of the general fund and to provide some of those ongoing things we can't pay for out of the general fund because we just don't have the resources for it. So that's really the impact of that is. Expenditures, again, pretty flat. And you can see some of the numbers there. I do want to talk about the bottom line of this chart. At the very bottom, you can see, we did talk about cutting a lot of expenditures and reducing our expenditures, I should say. But you can look, we've spent $53 million, $53.2 and $53.1 on instruction. And that number's been pretty darn consistent for what we're putting into the classroom, if you will. Supporting services were down about $600, and our other was down about $700. That's really where the savings is coming from. So not in that direct instructional line. I like it. This is one of the slides I really like. I like looking at it on a per pupil analysis. And I give you a lot of credit for a lot of decisions you guys made to get to this point. We had 4 years in a row where we were spending more than we were taking in, and obviously we can't continue to do that in this day and age, and we hear more and more in the paper about all the things that are going on with these districts that are struggling and don't have any fund balance left. Well, you guys got on the right side of that now, and it's good to see. And hopefully we can keep that stable for years to come, but 4 of the last 5 years have been down. So what's left? Our savings account, our unrestricted fund balance. If you talk about $1.3 million, $1.4 million, total fund balance compared to our expenditures is only 12%. Unrestricted, 11. Those are both up 2% from a year ago. And in the grand scheme of things, 365-day calendar and 180-day calendar, those are 45 days of operations and 22 days of operations, up 7 days and 4 days. So even though that's a big number, when you're looking at an $80 million budget, it's not that big a number, but you can see the impact it has. At least it's moving in the right direction. So it doesn't take one hiccup to go the wrong way. You can see this is your fund balance trend, though I think it was 47% last year when we dropped it down, and now we're back up. So it's a decrease of 27% from 2012 levels. So we are back above 14 levels, which is good, and healthier, but still a little bit of work to go to make sure we are doing everything we can. Any questions on the financial piece? That's kind of the overview of the general fund I have. I'll talk a little bit about the bond, too. Again, we're doing some extensive bond testing. Anytime you have a bond like this, and obviously the voters approve that, we'll issue a separate bond report when the projects are all done, and we'll have that for you guys as well. So we're auditing those transactions ongoing throughout the year. So we don't wait till the very end to go test that. We test it as we go throughout the process. And at the end of that, we'll issue an opinion and a report so you have that, so you can have some comfort that, hey, those funds are being spent appropriately. And we review it for the bond language, and we make sure everything's showing up at the right place as best we can. So there's some things that go on with that. So that's some of the testing we did this year. We looked hard at the debt payments. So it was new to the district, took on some debt for that, obviously. We looked at bid testing, addresses of some of the deliveries we checked on. We looked at credit cards, sinking fund, we looked at that extensively, disbursements, payroll, and then we spent a lot of time on the IT. I talked about this earlier. We had one little issue this year, really, our pledges receivable. Not the pledges we got in, because we got all that money in. It's just the future years needed to be recognized. And you see in the general fund, that money was just a receivable and a deferral. No impact on the general fund, but that number just needed to be recognized. And we have no really deficiencies in controls or management comments. I think we've done a real nice job with our systems in place. We also test compliance. We tested a major program this year was nutrition. And I give a lot of credit to that staff as well, as the ones handling the nutrition area. We tested 68 different areas of compliance for food service, nutrition cluster, and we have no findings. So that's a lot of digging, a lot of looking, a lot of little things that you could find along the way, but our staff has done an excellent job in that area as well. New slide this year, one of the things I like to talk about a little bit is we have some challenges facing us, not just us, but every district and every government really in the state of Michigan has very similar issues. Rising healthcare costs. We made some significant changes to our healthcare, moving away from self-insurance a little over a year ago. So again, we're more subject to the premium-based stuff now, and I've heard a lot of the premiums have been going up. So we'll see what that means in the future. So it's always, when you saw 87% of your costs are in salary and fringe benefits, that fringe benefit factor continues to grow way faster than the salary piece of that does. Our state funding, one of the things I like to point out is we received $4.9 million. It's called 147 seed money. And that's to hold down the retirement rate, which is at 34%. They're paying $4.9 million. They send it to us, we send it right back to them, and it goes into the MIPSERS pool of pension money. So it grosses up our revenues, grosses up our expenses, and it goes out. Our pension obligation, we started recognizing that a year ago. That number was $118 million last year. We paid $4.9 more in, 34% of our salaries went into that, their employees. And that number went up $8 million, our share of it, even though we put in all that extra money. So talk about state funding. It's great when they're holding down the rate and paying you $5 million for that. Economy's been good. What does that mean in the future? I don't know that you can bank on any of that. So you always have to be worried about that. We have some contractual obligations related to some of the financial decisions we've made in there we have to look at, as well as our construction commitments we have out there. So we have some contractual obligations we need to be make sure we're following through in those. We talked about the pension. We have post-retirement health care. That's the second half of that MIPSERS, which is the state pension plan. That's the pension obligation. The health care piece is coming June 30th of 18, and that's going to be a pretty big number, too. They say it could be as big as the liability for pension. So that's another number. We'll continue to pay the rate just like we do in our general fund and spend that, but that number is going to show up on our books again. And then energy costs have been going up a little bit. We've had better than average winter, I guess, last year. But again, energy costs continue to rise, and that's always something you have to be aware of. So with that, I thank Mr. Sherrow, Mr. Cooper, and Mrs. Holerby for all their help this year. I think it went very, very well. I'm very pleased to be here. So any questions I can answer for the board?
comment as treasurer of the board. One of our biggest obligations as board members is to make sure we're spending the taxpayers' money correctly and right, and having this independent audit gives us our report card of who we hire to do that. And I love the A-plus report card we get every year that where we think we're spending the money, we are actually spending the money. So thank you, all of our staff and all you guys who've put in all that time and energy for integrity and honesty of where we spend our money. And I can't underestimate how important that is, because once we lose that, we've lost the game.
Right.
And so many other districts have lost the game of that integrity, and that's a rock stone here in Midland. And I'm just so glad to see an A-plus come back.
Awesome.
On that I see it as an integrity grade, nothing more. The other comment I would make is on the future challenges, it's just fascinating. Two of them are totally uncontrollable by us, and they're the biggest ones, the pension and the post-retirement health insurance. That's controlled by the state. They took control. They botched it up. Now we're paying for it. And I hate that. It drives me crazy. But it is what it is. The others are semi-controllables. And the fact they're semi-controllable, I feel very good that we've put things in place to control them, our end of it, as best as we can. So, again, thanks to the staff for that. And just keep knocking on Lansing's door on these totally uncontrollable issues that are pounding us.
It's great to see we're on the positive side of the revenue and expenses, and it's also great to see that we're adding to our fund balance. And like you said, we've got a ways to go, but we are definitely in the heading in the right direction. So appreciate your time, and also the time that Bob and the rest of your team have put into this.
I wonder if you could repeat something for me.
Sure.
I think it's worth the general public noting what we support we get. You made a comment about pledges receivable.
Yeah.
Other districts, what they do or don't get, and what you've seen with us. I think it's worth noting the support we get and how grateful we are.
It is incredible, that kind of support in this community, in any community. I've seen it at one other district, but not to the significance. I've been doing this 22 years now, and I think it's just a tremendous community project you guys put together, and getting the bond, the citizens behind that, and then the foundations come behind that and support on top of that, help us even control the cost even more, and maybe do even a little bit more for those students. It's going to be great.
Thank
I can't wait to see it next year.
Thank you.
Very good.
Very exciting. So thank you, and thank you to everyone who, and especially Lori there. She has done a lot this year. She came in, I can't even remember what month you came in, but she's had to take over all the financials, and new this year, the bonds, so a lot of extra that no one had been through before, and she has done an outstanding job. And we saw that tonight with how fast we were able to get through this, and really appreciate all the time that you put into it.
Thanks, Dave.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dave.
All right, so I think at this time, though, we need to vote to approve it.
Yeah.
Okay. So I will entertain a motion to accept the 2015-16 audit report.
I move to accept the 2015-16 audit report as presented.
All right.
Second.
Moved by Jerry, seconded by Pam. Is there any other discussion? All right, all those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. All those opposed? All right, the audit report passes. Next up is 3.2, which is our tax resolution for winter of 2016.
Okay. And I see where we are on the agenda, and know there are kids waiting to speak, so we'll keep this fast and furious, because as exciting as the tax resolution can be, it's really So anyways, we talk often in the budget, we talk about what our millage rates are going to be. This is really just the official setting. That there's a form behind it, which you guys know you have to approve, called the L4029, and it really just sets those millage rates. For us, the big difference, of course, is our hold harmless. We do wait till now to calculate it, just in case our tax base changes enough, because it fluctuates. If you remember, our hold harmless lets us generate $415.31 a student and no more. So you're playing a game guessing how many students you're going to have, what the tax base will be, and then you calculate a rate. This coming year will be 1.6814, which is about a tenth different than a year ago. It's down a tenth, which is graduates happen as time goes on. Tax base grows. You don't have to levy as much to get that amount of money. And the other one would be our bond debt repayment, which was new to us last year at 2.95, and we talked about this in June, too, when we did the budget. but it will be at 2.88 for this year. And of course, people in the city already have been taxed 1.44 of that because the city does do 50%. So this requires a roll call vote. The nice part is you don't have to read the resolution anymore, but you have the resolution there. Takes a roll call vote, and you also are authorizing the president and, in this case, the treasurer to sign the L-4029, and then with Cindy's help, we send it out to all the appropriate parties, which are all the taxing agencies in the county and also state agencies. So it gets sent out to, I don't know exactly how many places, but a few. So board would need to, and of course, we're recommending that you approve this, but you need to do that through a roll call vote.
Time, I'll entertain a motion.
Well, as treasurer, I'll move to approve certification resolution for the 2016-17 fiscal year taxes, and a complete copy of the resolution will be shall be attached to the original of these minutes.
Support.
Okay, moved by Jerry, support by Lynn. Are there any questions or comments?
Is that supported by Yvonne or Lynn?
Lynn.
It was Lynn.
Are there any questions or comments?
Just a note for the public that Bob talked about the hold harmless. That was all part of the Prop A, we'll call it negotiation settlement back in 95, 96,
maybe
roughly.
It was 93.
94. 93
that early. So it's been 20.
94.
94. So it's been 22 years, and it's still $415 a student. So imagine what the purchasing power of that 415 was 22 right. years ago against what that purchasing power is 415 is today, and what it will be like 20 years from now. And that millage rate has gone down almost 70%.
Right. Well, I know we had the discussion. I don't remember what it started out as when it was.
It was 5.2 when it started.
Okay.
5.2 versus 5.0, yeah. So 1.6, that's about right.
Yep. Okay. But we are still
70%.
Very appreciative of
oh, yes. Thank you, taxpayers. We'll take it.
Absolutely.
Makes a lot of difference. So, all right. Are there any more questions or comments? All right. At this time, if you could do a roll call vote for us, please, ma'am.
I will. President Branstad?
Yes.
Vice President Singer? Yes. Secretary McFarland is absent. Treasurer Wasserman?
Yes.
Member Baker?
Yes.
Member Frazee?
Yes.
Member Gordon?
Yes.
All right. The tax resolutions have passed.
Angela, the other one I think we should point out is 2.95 on the bond is now 2.88.
Yes.
So, that's due to taxable values, not so much our part, but that's a good thing for taxpayers as well.
Yes. All right. Moving into 4.1.
You got it. You guys, you can see we have East Lawn Elementary with us today, and they're going to talk about summer extension program. And I don't know if Shannon or Jennifer's going to, Shannon's going to do it.
But tomorrow at school, they're talking tax resolution.
Right. actually, I'm going to be really brief because I have Mrs. Service and we have our tremendous summer extension program staff and, of course, our students here to share. And so I have the privilege of just introducing everyone to you this evening. And tonight, really, you're going to see the culmination of some discussion that Mrs. Service and I had about the ideas for what our summer extension program would look like this year, and knowing that we've been working toward PYP or IBPYP, and knowing that we have STEM coming along, there has been a big question of how are we going to make this go together, and can we do this, and what's this going to look like? So we took the opportunity this summer to experiment and be risk takers, as you know in the learner profile for PYP. We took risk taking to a wonderful level this summer and had a tremendous outcome. And with that, I will give you Mrs. Service so she can introduce to you more of the details. Thank you.
I don't think I need the stool. Good evening, my name is Jen Service and I am the PYP coordinator for both East Lawn and Carpenter Elementary Schools. I was hired to coordinate the summer extension program at East Lawn, and when meeting with Shannon, as she just said, to discuss possible options for the summer extension program, it was very clear that we had the same vision, PYP and STEM integration. And so there our journey began. A little snippet, our summer extension program ran for 15 days over the course of 5 weeks, and it was funded through Title I. We met Tuesday through Thursday each week from 8:30 in the morning until 1:30 in the afternoon, and students were provided with snack, breakfast, and lunch each day. We took a field trip or had guest speakers visit our building each week to connect to our weekly focus. We had 5 classrooms this summer for students entering first grade through students entering fifth grade. There were 15 students in each class with 1 classroom teacher and 1 paraprofessional. And even though the screen is here, I would like to take a moment to recognize my awesome staff, dedicated teachers and paraprofessionals that are here with us tonight. So they'll wave behind the screen.
Thank you.
So we are here tonight to share our wonderful learning experiences with you, and I have brought along some of my East Lawn friends to share their summer highlights with you. We'll just do this up and down. Hold on, great. So first off, I would like to introduce third grade teacher Mrs. Jillian Strubel to share her teaching experience with PYP and STEM.
When the opportunity came about to teach summer school, I knew that it would be a great opportunity for me to continue to grow as an educator of the primary years program and learn how to incorporate STEM into that. With our new Central Park Elementary coming to fruition more and more each day, I knew that continued practice and exposure was essential to my continued growth as an educator. What a joy it was for me to facilitate inquiry-based lessons with my incoming third graders and to watch them synthesize and develop ideas through experimentation and questioning. I was able to witness firsthand the collaboration, experimentation, and frustration that came from constructing a toothpick house that could withhold the weight of 10 grams and the blowing of a fan, to the manipulation of parts of a car to promote a greater distance of travel in a straighter line, and developing a theory to justify how in the world hooking alligator clips to celery can turn that vegetable into piano keys. These activities, along with many others, gave students and myself a glimpse of the structure of our future school day. I'm confident that through the day-to-day learning that incorporates STEM subjects and the primary years program, that teachers can inspire students to become active and informed citizens in an ever more complex world. The skills that students obtain from increased exposure to STEM education can be applied to any number of careers. I've seen firsthand how students can rise to the challenges before them as critical thinkers and effective problem solvers, and will essentially allow them to be productive members of society in an ever-changing world.
So first off, a PYP planner was written for the summer extension group. We worked with the transdisciplinary theme, How the World Works, and we had a unit of inquiry boards in each classroom. We worked to integrate the framework of PYP, the essential elements of PYP, and the concepts of STEM education. Our central idea focus for this unit was through investigation, people learn how to solve problems in the world. And the 3 lines of inquiry that we focused on was an inquiry into how different situations require different investigations, an inquiry into how people find tools and or resources to solve problems, and definitely an inquiry into success through trial and error. A variety of learning experiences were crafted for each grade level and centered around these 3 lines of inquiry. Finally, we worked with the key concepts of connection, reflection, and form, and the related concepts of pattern, structure, and imagination. So STEM connections. We broke our summer school down into weeks, S for science, T for technology, E for engineering, and M for math. It was great to see that as each week passed, students were making connections between all 4 of the STEM areas. Many guest speakers were brought in over the course of the summer. Our guests range from our very own superintendent and associate superintendent to a nurse, a coach, a dentist, a magician, and a business owner, just to name a few. Each individual presenter shared their favorite book with students, discussed his or her job or hobby, and also discussed the tools needed for their job. All presenters, no matter the job, were able to discuss the impact and importance of science, math, engineering, and technology to their current job or hobby. It was an amazing experience for our students. Also on the first day of summer extension, students created anchor charts. Students were asked, what do you know about science, technology, engineering, and math? The ideas began to generate, and what was great to see is as their knowledge grew, so did our anchor charts. There was so much visible thinking in each and every classroom. Now we would like to share some of the learning experiences with you. So week one was our math focus. Our focus was on geometry and tessellations. We made great connections and related the concept of patterns when we held a Dr. Seuss study. Our teachers and students visited the Midland Center for the Arts to see The Art of Dr. Seuss. Students were able to explore the Dr. Seuss sculptures at Dow Gardens. I would like to invite my friend Levi up to share a favorite learning experience from Math Week.
Hi, my name is Levi, and I am in third grade. My favorite part was working to build a house at the Dr. Seuss exhibit. I worked with cardboard, tinfoil, and tape. I got to be an engineer when I thought about the designs of my house when I worked to build it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Week two was our technology week. Students and staff learned all about the Hour of Code with Miss Julie Hyatt. Students worked on iPads and laptops to learn basic computer programming. Students also visited the Delta College Planetarium during Science Week and learned about outer space. We learned about the different technology used in space and in space travel. My friends Gavin and Ruben would like to share a favorite technology experience with you.
My name is Gavin. I am Hi, my name is Gavin. I am third grade. One of my favorite parts of summer school was Makey Makey. We put tin foil on a wrist and then hooked the alligator clips to the foil in the Makey Makey. Then we connected the clips to celery and made a piano. We experimented and inquired the scientists. We took the tin foil off our wrist and tried the experiment again, and it worked. We hope to show you this when we are done with our presentation today. Also, in summer school, I love making new friends.
Hi. My name is Ruben. I am in first grade. My favorite thing was the planetarium. We learned about outer space. I loved the movie and the roller coaster.
Next, week three was our science week. Students and staff had a wonderful learning experience aboard the Appledore in Bay City. Students learned about our local wetlands, invasive species, water pollution, and conservation. Students created their very own ecosystems in a bottle. These were used throughout the course of summer for study, inquiry, investigation, and journaling. Students learned about the properties of matter during science week by creating oobleck slime. Here to share a favorite experience from Science Week is my friend Reba.
Hi, my name is Reba, and my favorite thing about summer school is making oobleck. We were scientists. It was super fun.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And week four was our engineering week. We had a week full of guests, the Dow ambassadors, the SVSU STEM Mobile Lab, the Dow High Robotics team, and Mr. Dave Shannon, our number one science volunteer. It was a wonderful week of exploration for our students, and many connections were made. Students created coaster cars with Mr. Shannon. This project was designed using the Project Lead the Way engineering design process. Here to tell you a little bit more about his engineering week favorite are my friends Paige and Landon.
Hi, my name is Landon. I am in fourth grade. I'm going to tell you about a time when we made coaster cars out of paper and wood. I did a thing where I put extra tape on mine to make it heavier because we were having a race. We were being engineers. We built unique designs. We used technology with the wheels on the car. We estimated how far it would travel and traveled and measured the distance. For math, we experimented what would work best and tried different strategies by adding washers to add weight because I knew the more weight it had, the faster it would go. That is how I used science, technology, math, and engineering for this activity. I engineered a car with lots of tape on the back and tape right here to hold more washers. And I chose the bigger wheels because I knew the bigger the wheels were, the faster it would go.
Hi, my name is Paige and I'm in fifth grade. One activity we did this summer for engineering week was a dice creation game. My group's goal was to build something that made noise, made people laugh, and that could hold a ball. We could only use cardboard, plastic cups, and tape. We worked as a team and independently. Another fun activity we did was having the Dow Robotics team come visit our school, showing us their robots. They gave us a chance to drive them. On that same day, the STEM bus visited our school. They showed us the world up close. Unique fish and a drone used to get samples made by the SVSU college students. This was a good and an interesting summer.
During our final week together, students worked on exhibition projects to share with parents and community members. We had a wonderful celebration on our last day together. Students were able to reflect and share their learning and connections with others, and we had a wonderful luncheon celebration together. We had over 100 people in attendance. Here to share her overall learning experience from Summer Extension is my friend Lacey.
Hi, my name is Lacey and I'm in fifth grade at East Long School. I love learning things at summer school, like one, we did not get any real tests. Two, I didn't do well at reading, but now I am better at reading because of summer school. Three, we had field trips. Four, we made new friends with all grades. I made a new friend with first grade. Five, we tried new things even if we thought we could not do it. Six, we got new school supplies for the grade you were going into. Seven, we didn't get any homework. Eight, we have recess just like normal school before lunch. Nine, we have awesome teachers like Mrs. Laddick, and paras and helpers like Mrs. Service and Mrs. Crowley. I know it might sound strange, but summer school can help children a lot. Last but not least, it's important that we got to have fun while learning. That's what I loved about learning at summer school.
Thank you. And finally, because this summer extension was made possible by Title I funds, parents were asked to complete a survey and give us feedback on the overall program. I would like to share a few parent comments with you. At first, he didn't want to admit that he was enjoying it, and today he told me that he was sad it was over. Aww. Thank you for making this educational and entertaining. My child had a blast and loved coming every day. Thank you for providing a great opportunity to continue learning during the summer. We would not have been able to attend without transportation, so thank you very much. My kids did amazing in the program, and they would love to come back. And finally, my child has benefited greatly from this program. She has always struggled academically, and this program allowed her to stay on track and gave her the opportunity to shine. And so we feel that overall, with those statements, that this program was a huge success. We thank you for having us tonight, and we are excited to begin our journey of integrating PYP and STEM, And most of all, we are proud to be East Lawn Eagles. Thank you.
Wonderful job presenting. I don't know if any of you were nervous, but it didn't seem like any of you were nervous. You all did a fabulous. Oh, you were nervous? I couldn't tell. You did a great job.
Yes, you did.
It sounds like a very fun program. So, and Landon, you did the car? Where's Landon? When you get older, you can come to work where I work for our summer interns. They get to build like not really cars, but go-karts, and they get to race them. So if you like that this year, you stay on track, and in a few years, when you're in college, you can come work where I work, and you can make a go-kart and race it around the track, and just keep getting bigger and bigger with your design ideas.
If we have another 30 seconds, they'd really like to show you the makey-makey.
Oh, yeah.
Gavin, do you want to help? You guys can go ahead.
This beats budget. This beats tax resolutions all the time.
Oh, no kidding. No kidding.
Okay, someone's getting rigged up here.
This won't hurt a bit.
Yeah, is this safe?
Yeah, this won't hurt a bit.
Don't try this at home.
Right.
Exactly. He willingly held out his arm.
And then the other one was hooking up bananas, and it makes bongos on
the. Oh wow!
Oh wow! Enough of the golf.
Wow!
Lots of fun. So thank you very much.
Can I ask them a question?
Sure.
Just as a group, raise your hand if you would go again next year. Would you go back to summer school next year?
All right.
Yeah.
There you go.
Great.
Nice.
Fantastic.
Job. Yeah. Nice job.
Very thank you for good. Doing
very
it.
Very impressive. Thank you. And thank you for sitting through the first part of our meeting.
Yeah.
I think I want to have homework tonight.
To say, I think I want to come next year.
Yeah.
Hi, guys.
Bye. Thank you.
You can go online. There's a YouTube. We have a YouTube
that's
station,
cool.
And it
that's
shows
about, right
the whole
there.
Presentation on it.
Yeah, that's well, they're all
yeah,
going.
It's yeah. Awesome. They get
they're
it
all going
to 45 miles an hour.
Parents got a taste of it.
Okay.
Transition.
Next up, 4.2 is the September Shining Stars.
I don't know if we can top that at all.
No.
And after our very dull summer meetings, isn't it nice to have the kids
it is.
Back?
It's great to have the kids nice. Back.
So our first Shining Star is Miss Tracy Renfro. Tracy would come up. Let me read a little bit about Tracy. First, her career highlights. Tracy earned her bachelor's degree in English from Central Michigan University in 1990 and her master's of arts from Northern Arizona University in administration in 1998. Before coming to MPS, Mrs. Renfro had 12 years of public school teaching and building administration experience in, I don't know if I can say it, in Mojave Valley, Arizona. Mrs. Renfro began her MPS career with Midland Public Schools in 2002 as an assistant principal at Jefferson Middle School. In 2008, she was named the interim principal of Chestnut Hill Elementary, and later that school year, she was named the permanent full-time Chestnut Hill principal, the position she continues in today. Tracy was nominated for a Shining Star Award by an MPS staff member. Among her comments, this employee writes, "Tracy Renfro is a shining star because she is an excellent leader of our school. Tracy generally cares for all of our staff and students. Chestnut Hill received the National Blue Ribbon Award last year, due not only to dedicated staff, but to the leader who knows how to put the right people in place to make things happen. Tracy leads her staff with high expectations and by the book, but does so in a kind and caring way. There is something even more special I want to share about Tracy. Yesterday, which we're talking when they nominate it. My husband had to have emergency triple bypass surgery. Tracy was supportive, almost family-like, and telling me not to worry that I would have good plans ready. Go take care of my husband. My family was not able to be with me during this major surgery. I was shocked when about 15 minutes into the surgery, Tracy walked in. She arranged to have someone cover Chestnut Hill so she could come be with me so I was not alone during this scary, very scary time. Tracy treated me not like a staff member, but a part of her family. Because of this very selfless act and Tracy's kind, caring friendship with all employees, as well as her blue ribbon leadership, I truly hope that Tracy can be recognized as an NPS Shining Star. Congratulations, Tracy. Support group with her today. Our second shining star is Laura Peterson. If Laura would come forward. Let me read a little bit about Laura. Laura earned her Bachelor of Science degree from Michigan Tech University. Ms. Peterson began her MPS career with Midland Public Schools in 1998 as a Media Center paraprofessional at Parkdale Elementary. In 2010, Laura was promoted to the role of District Media Paraprofessional. As a full-time paraprofessional, Laura works with the support and Media Center paraprofessionals across the district. She plans and leads training sessions for the media paras. Laura was nominated for the Shining Star by an MPS colleague. Among his comments, the staff member wrote, "Laura continued to works to ensure that our Media Center staff has the knowledge and tools they need to support teachers in their work and students in their learning. Most recently, Laura led the effort to upgrade our library system software and has been instrumental in working with the Grace A. Dow Memorial Library to develop a partnership where certain resources can be accessed by our students while at school. Laura is a problem solver and makes visits to each school's media center to provide individual training on anything the media staff needs. It is evident in her work that Laura is passionate about our media centers, and we are very grateful that she is part of our team. Congratulations, Laura." We'd like to also recognize our 2016 Distinguished Service Awards. You can see as Cindy's putting that down. We recognized them on opening day with our staff on August 31st. This award is modeled after the Gerstacker Proficiency Award, Teacher Awards. It was first done in 2002. And here are our winners this year. We have Chuck Dobczynski, Building Manager at Northeast. Cheryl Szymanski, Paraprofessional at Chestnut Hill. And Chev Gardner, Register Midland High, and Vicki Finney, Manager Transportation Department. So congratulations to our support staff. As you know, without support, nothing would really go on. That's a good representation of them. So bring it to your attention.
It was great how the recognition went, and I will say there was a tear in the eye, and it wasn't the three ladies.
Yep. All right, we're to item five, which is request to address the board. Do we have any formal requests? Any? No. Okay. Is there anyone who would like to address the board?
Well, they're all leaving.
Okay. With that, then we will move into, thanks for coming, everybody.
Thank you.
We will move into item 6.0, administrative services. And let's see, I'm assuming there was no meeting. And so we just have the NEOLA food service policy revision.
Correct. So we were brought to our attention that we needed a slight change in the words when we went through review this year. So it's policy 8500 NEOLA, and you have the changes there. I won't go through and read it, but it was some wording changes to meet the compliance.
Okay.
So Laurie, that was reported to Laurie, and we made the change. It is been sent to Neil. I'm not sure it's officially in the policy manual yet until your
approval.
Until
we vote for it. Mm-hmm. So, okay.
And
so
it has to do with a la carte pricing that, you know, if it goes up, the USDA portion of it, then we'll have to move ours up as well.
Oh, okay.
You've done that a couple times, if you recall. Yes.
Okay, so this is an item for action.
Correct.
So if I have a motion.
I move approval of agenda item 6.1.
Support.
Okay, moved by Yvonne, support by Jerry. Is there any questions or discussion? All right, all those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? All right, policy revision passes. Moving on to item 7.0, which is FFO, and we did have a study committee meeting
on September 12th.
Week. Okay.
And Angela, Patrick, and I were in attendance along with Mike, Bob. We did a review of the, Mr. Youngstrom and Ms. Roth reviewed the 2015-16 audit with the FFO committee. Topics included various sections of the audit report, fund balance and general fund, net assets, financial statements, single audit, governance communication, and new and upcoming accounting pronouncements. The public presentation of the audit will take place, as you heard tonight. We also received some, independently, we received some appraisals on some selected school properties that are owned throughout the district, just to understand a little bit where we're at and what they may or may not be worth in the marketplace. And the L4029 tax rate request was going to be presented at tonight's board meeting, as it was. Our next meeting will be October 10th at 5 p.m.
All right, thank you very much. Moving on to item 7.2.
We have two items tonight, both just for information, but we have gifts again, like we were talking earlier about the big pledges, but it never ceases to amaze me. We're barely started, and you'll see that not only do we have an item there, but $6,000 right at the start of the school year, too. So in 7.2, we have a marching band xylophone bell kit. Mr. and Mrs. Kevin Scroggins gave that. Cindy and I had to check with the music department, so we knew what it was. We didn't know, but it would look good, so we knew that. And it was. It's very nice. That was good. And then you'll see, basically, at this time of year, we'll see a lot of these gifts in 7.3. Chestnut Hills, $3,000 for, they used it for classroom magazine subscriptions, $1,000 from Plymouth PTO for classroom supplies. And then you'll also see the Jefferson JPAC Parent Advisory Committee. And they did $1,000 for some football basketball equipment, and then $1,000 for some general athletic equipment. And I can tell you just from the gift requests I've seen, you know, that didn't make this board meeting, you'll see other PTOs coming along with the same thing, and they call them teacher wish lists, or it's field trips, or it's money that they're raising internally besides all the external sources. So that's just for information tonight.
Thank you. Thank you to all the donors.
And
very much appreciated.
Quick comment. You know what I really like about this is it's the donors owning their schools. You know, they're doing it for their kids and their schools and making a local decision of what's best in that little situation. And that's great that that they do that and stand up and not wait for someone like us to do things that might have to be done in their building.
Right. I also appreciate, you know, when you have this xylophone, people thinking of us for things like that.
Yes.
I remember several years ago, I remember someone donated a car for the auto shop, and I thought, I don't know if I would have ever thought about that. It's such a great help for our district to provide opportunities for all our children. All right, moving into human resources.
And we have two retirements for you there. Linda Kurtz, a paraprofessional at Jefferson Middle School, and Tracy Tasky, our information systems analyst, will have announced their retirements.
All right, best of luck to both of them as they go on to their next stage. All right, at this time, item 9 is correspondence to and from the Board of Education. Item 10 is scheduled activities for information. Our next regularly scheduled board meeting will be October 17th. And at this time, we will move into our study discussion. And I will start with you, Patrick.
All right. Thought I saw Mike the first day of school, incredibly high attendance rates. Always nice to see.
Yep.
See your parents and everybody helping out for the first day, and appreciate that. Welcome to all the new teachers. I was able to meet with them for lunch just a few weeks ago, and nice to see bunch of smiling faces. I felt old walking in there, but it was nice to see. Great to see the audit findings. Again, I've come on recently new, so I appreciate the work that you've put in to get us to this schedule. I know I look at it as this is always this way, but I know that we've come long ways to get to where we are. The summer extension program, I think it's worth mentioning the students' names: Levi, Gavin, Reba, Ruben, Paige, Landon, and Lacey. All did an awesome job talking tonight. Nice to hear them excited about being scientists and wanting to be engineers. I think there was a quote in there: "She had fun while she was learning." That's maybe the best thing I heard all night. Mm-hmm. And Mrs. Pierce and Mrs. Renfro, congrats to them. My kids are with Mrs. Renfro every day, and I couldn't be happier to have them attend Chestnut Hill.
Again, great start to the school year. I'm glad it went safely. Mm-hmm. That time of change always makes me nervous. Yep. Around the school buildings. So that's wonderful. Congratulations, nice shiny stars. I said it earlier, but it bears repeating. One of the big obligations I feel as a board member is the integrity of our system. And one of the bigger integrities is the financial side, because it's a lot of money. And it just, it's an expectation of mine, but it's also very thankful of me when we get these clean audit reports that say everything's copacetic and these guys are doing a great job. So thank you for the clean audit report. And the East Lawn students tonight, you know, if I came away with one thing, I came away with, boy, are we going the right direction with our STEM strategy, et cetera. It just comes through in steroids, and I can't wait, you know, a decade from now, what that's going to look like and what the kids graduating are going to look like, because we're doing our elementaries and subsequently the other levels as we go through. So that just warmed my heart, not just for them and their summer, but for what's to come.
I looked at the Midland Public School website today and watched the drone video again, and it's exciting to see we have roofs on almost the whole building. So just watching that all come together again is very neat. The last video, the one prior to this, I was watching at the end, they circled around and showed the whole exterior. It made me a little dizzy and a little sick, but made me feel like I was on a roller coaster. But it's fun to watch the updates through that video. I appreciate that. The computer deployment I thought was fabulous, with that many devices to go out with hardly a hitch was amazing. So nice job, mm-hmm. Tech guys. Great Lakes Bay Region has a STEM weekend coming up September 23rd and 24th at Delta College. It's a Friday and Saturday. I know schools are sending students from around the region, but on Saturday, it's an opportunity for parents to bring their own kids, and it's an event to really check out. I went last year, and I was floored, and it's a great opportunity to get your kids excited about STEM. We looked at the data this week. Mr. Sherrow sent us data on the college application week and college readiness and enrollment numbers. And the thing that impressed me about the numbers that we saw through that is how we're looking at outcomes, not just graduation rates for our students, but we're looking to see how they're doing 6 months and 2 years after graduation. And to me, that's what we're really trying to do. We're trying to prepare our kids for the future, not just graduation. So I truly appreciate those numbers that were shared. And things I'm looking forward to is to learn more about the STEM partnership with SVSU and MSU. I know a lot is happening there, and it'll be fun to see how that really adds to our STEM initiative. PYP training went great. I've heard over and over from several different folks how impactful that was, and that was over 50 teachers were involved, so it's very exciting as well. That's all I have.
Well, I just wanted to say welcome to our new teachers, and I hope being part of Midland Public Schools is a great experience for them. I hope everybody has a great learning year. And somebody said having the students back was nice, and it was. And that was very exciting. It was, I felt like I could feel their excitement and their enthusiasm just by listening to them and looking at their faces as they gave their presentation. That was, some of them did seem maybe a little nervous, but they also seemed like they really, really enjoyed it. So that was great. It was nice to see all the people from Chestnut Hill here tonight. So that's it. Just hope everybody has a great learning year.
Well, a lot has already been said that I had jotted down, but I think one of the highlights is having our students back. And boy, you know, I don't remember summer school ever being this exciting and right. Such enthusiasm. Right. And all of them want to come back next year. So, and there's a lot of time and effort that goes in by the staff and all those that are preparing and teaching. And thank you to all the community members or organizations. I mean, wow, what neat field trips. The Appledore and you know, Dow Gardens, mm-hmm. the planetarium. It's just pretty marvelous stuff for the kids. If they're not excited, if that doesn't make learning exciting, I don't know what would.
I'm ready to sign up.
I know, me yeah. too. So to hear that at the beginning of the school year with all the things that we are looking forward to for the year and excitement with learning, I mean, they're just, they definitely are good spokespersons for all of us here. Congratulations to Tracy and Laura. I've worked with both of them and with volunteer efforts, and Laura especially over the years. I have volunteered for many, many years at Northeast at the Media Center and have watched it go from, well, it wasn't still card catalog, but a lot different than what it is now, and it's just amazing. Laura is right there and on the front lines all the time with the rest of her tech people, and it's pretty amazing stuff, so well-deserved. I did see in the paper the other day that the United Way, I can't remember what the name of it was, you probably remember, Mike, but all the schools and classrooms had volunteers from the community mm-hmm. come in and read Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible, Very Bad Day, and I thought that's just really neat, and it's the kids enjoy seeing somebody come in and especially to read books and that fun book. So thank you again for that partnership, and welcome all these new teachers. It was fun to meet them at the luncheon, but I've seen a couple of them around now, and they're getting settled in, and I guess I should also say congratulations to the retirees. I'm sure they're off doing who knows what and having lots of fun. I know a couple of them, and they are. So I guess here's to a great, great school year ahead.
All right, and I guess I'll add, I mean, everyone has said a lot, but I'll add congratulations to the 2016 Distinguished Service Award winners. Great having the East Lawn kids here. I think it's another reminder to all of us that learning really isn't September through June. I mean, learning is year-round, and sometimes we call it formal learning, but really we're all learning all the time, and this was just another example of another way of students being able to learn and have some excitement for learning. Jerry has said a lot on our audit report tonight. I would like to reemphasize some of that. It was, it's always good to have a clean audit, and really it shows a lot of how far we've come in the past few years, and a lot of us have been here through that whole time, and it's we know the hard work that went into all of this, why we tried to balance the educational opportunities that we've been able to offer, but while making sure that financially we can maintain what we have. So thank you once again to everybody who's helped that. Congratulations to the new teachers. I know my daughter has one, and she came home last night and said, I can't wait for you to meet my teacher Wednesday night because we have our Dow High parent walkthrough. So obviously to her that's going very well, so I'm excited to meet her also. And then notice really good Monday newsletter communique today. Good stuff. Everyone should take some time to read it. Profiles National Merit semifinalists. So
very impressive.
It was very impressive. It was more impressive because then I took the time to go on the Michigan. There was a thing you could pull down and look at some other districts, and we were very well represented for the size of our district. So congratulations to all those students who have that designation this year. So I was at Iowa State this past week, and I did a presentation to the Society of Women Engineers, and I shamelessly, as I am out there recruiting, I realize they're not of the age where they're thinking about children, but I said, oh, where I live, we are developing a STEM elementary school. And they did actually, I mean, I seem to get some kids that seem to respond to that, like they thought it was very cool. So anyway, it just came out while I was talking. Anyway, that is all I have for tonight. So I will turn it over to you, Mike.
Well, off of some of that, the PYP STEM, your comments on a piece of it. One of the things I noticed tonight is, remember, these are at-risk learners. And look how engaged they were during the summer months of learning. And the other part, I can't help but thinking with Jerry's comment about what is our output, our product going to be 10 years from now. These are at-risk kids. Look how confident they were standing in front of you
they
tonight.
They were great.
And composed. So, and a lot of credit goes to Gen Service and the group that there. They did a great job all summer with them as well. I share this with you. Are joining the most famous names in STEM, talking about our STEM school and the outdoor learning spaces that are being developed over there and our partnership with Midland Area Community Foundation. They have developed a pamphlet for that. I'll pass it around. A very impressive pamphlet. It definitely will make me be willing to donate some money to that, so make sure you take a look and consider that as we send that around as well. Pam and Jerry and I attended I guess we'd call it a long night.
Oh, yes, while I was presenting at Iowa State, that's true.
And Claire Gladwin last week about the superintendent evaluation tool. You know, it was we saw the tool. You know, that tool, we had some doubts about the size of it and the difficulty of using it, but I think we walked away with some ideas. We have a little bit of work to do. I'll do some of that work and submit it back to you, and then we go back for our final training on December 14th, and so we should be ready to go when the new year goes forward with an idea how we're going to use that tool. And in the process, I think, is part of what we're looking at. Right. How do we make it work for the way we function here at Midland Public Schools as well? The deployment of the devices, you know, I wrote to you and said that they were slightly delayed. I think we originally were going to spend 2 days at each high school to do, and so we were behind, and when Dave's group finally got them, deployed all in one day at Dow High and all in one day at Midland High. So thank you, Dave and Chris, who are sitting here tonight. What a great job, and all the people that helped them do that. It went well. Think about that, you know, 1,400 devices out to students in high school. You know, and I was trying to think about it for tonight. So we're 1-to-1 in our high school, we're 1-to-1 in our middle schools. And I don't know, Dave, maybe you could throw a number at this. I was kind of thinking we're probably 70% or 2 students to 1 device in the elementary even right now. Yeah, because you take the title dollars at East Lawn, you know, and how close they are to being true 1-to-1. We're very close even at the elementary. So, again, that bond is paying benefit, and how close and how much advancement we're making moving forward with all of the technology and those pieces as well. I'm gonna bring this one up. So the transgender policy of Michigan Department of Ed, we've been following that closely, quietly. I'm wondering where that's gonna go. I still think, remember, it's guidance. It's not policy that we have to implement. I still think our best practice is what we plan to do is deal with case by case and try to figure out with each case how it's appropriate for the student, the parents, this school district, and the community. And we'll work with Neil and our school attorneys as we follow this guidance going forward. It's still my belief that this is going to get decided in the courts, and it'll probably be eventually decided at the Supreme Court level. And so we don't want to be the one paying for the legal bill to go there. And so we will move cautiously forward as we go through. And I want our community to know that as we go forward, and we'll continue to talk with them. Enrollment, and I think Patrick alluded to before, lots of faces in those schools on the first day. We've been tracking it. We were so cautious, we kept not sure that truly we could be that high, and enrollment keep moving forward. And at the end, we had to add some staff, and it does look like enrollment will probably come in at least even, if not up. It's certainly above what we budget, which is good. We probably have a few stretch points in the district right now. I think and I don't have an answer for you on how to fix that. We're probably a little bit tight in a few spots because so much came in late. And so, you know, when times where you're financially really strong, you might have left a little extra staffing, but when we're trying to watch it and keep it tight, and an unpredicted late increase caused some of those issues. So we added some staffing to relief. We just recently, as early as last week, added some FTE into Jefferson Middle School, which will give it a little release. If you recall, we had 4 elementary classrooms going in the last 10 days before we opened school. And so the art position we talked about hiring tonight, that's an increase. There's a part of an increase there as well. And so I think our class sizes are very good across the board, but it was definitely tight in the beginning and causing some issues, as we saw 30 new faces in Siebert in the last 10 days for school, for example. And we've never experienced that. So,
Mike, I will say those are good problems to have.
Very good to have.
I'll take the problems that way.
Yeah, very excited. Bond update, and I think we're going to work on a more of a bond update for the whole community here soon. I think you guys have talked about the school, and it's progressing well, very well. Our construction manager will never say they're ahead of schedule, but I think they're ahead of schedule. And you can see just from the drone footage, you know, their goal was to be completely enclosed before the snow falls.
Right.
Well, we're not, that drone footage shows they're not far from
snow. We don't want snow anytime soon.
Yeah. So we're ahead of schedule there. And the auditorium, if you recall, we had to break up that bid because we did the HVAC envelope bid, and then we're doing the new bid because we kind of had to take our time and make sure we did that right. They're just about done designing. We're waiting for the estimating on it, and that will be bid out soon. So the auditorium's moving forward. And then secure entrances are being designed with the additions at the elementaries. All secure entrances in the district going forward. We will do a secure entrance at Adams, but in its first year, it's going to be electronic lockdown instead of Sallyport, because if you recall, that office reconstruction is going to be pretty major, and they want to take a little time to do that. So to make sure they're still secure, it'll be the buzzing system with a camera. So they'll be very safe, very locked, but it'll be a 1 year, and then they'll get to Sallyport to follow the other schools. So a little bit of a change there as the architect began to try to figure out Adams. And then along with the secure entrances, which will start next April, take about, we hope to have them all completed by September 1. There will also begin the full renovations of Plymouth and Woodcrest going in this school year. That will take probably a year, but you'll begin to see what the additions at each school will look like, slightly different at each, but it'll be kind of the footprint for going forward of the additions and how that some of that space becomes STEM maker space and those pieces in the other elementaries as well. So it'll be very exciting moving forward on those. Now Scott gave you guys a couple board members update in our committee meetings today about our countywide CTE. That has gone exceptionally well. And so as we expected, our enrollment, we would probably gain being the larger offering more programs we have. But it's, we're sending 11 students out to Dow or Coleman's Ag program, which is great for our kids, a great opportunity in a very relative field that we would not have had that opportunity had we not all been cooperating. So it's a very good, we're transporting up and down kind of like that Saginaw corridor, and that's gone pretty well as well going forward. So that's all I have for you tonight.
Great.
That's a good bunch.
Yeah, I was going to say, is there anything else? All right, so at this time, we will end the meeting. Thank you all very much.